This video is an introduction into Wino 6 for designers and architects, and if you open Wino 6 the first time, it could be that you work with the wrong language for your interface. We work with the English interface, so I just go into options, and in this terms, because it's a German version, I go into Darstellung and I can change the language. If you can't find the right language, for example like English, you have to install this language before you can use it. And the next thing, you just restart your computer, and here we go. Before we start, you want to look at some other basic setups, so I just go again into options, and we want to have a look at files, and you can see that there is an autosave every 5 minutes, which is really important. If I just open this, and I probably go one step back, then with right mouse click into open in a window, I can just open my autosave and probably get to my recovered autosaved files. Also really important, before you start a project, you just have to look at the units. So I just go into units, and for example, if I work in meters, you just have to think about the absolute tolerance. For example, if the absolute tolerance is 0.001, then we are around about 1 millimeter precision. And if it's just like this, then my precision is only around 1 centimeter, which is definitely not enough. The reason why it's not enough is because there are different kind of ways to create objects, and there are some really exact ways, like entering a radius and a distance. That's all fine, but if you use a Boolean operation, or you just join objects or surfaces, then you never get a really exact result. It's always an approximation, and the higher the value is, the more precise your object. So if millimeter is important, then I would recommend that you even go one step further, and then you are absolutely on the safe side. Also really important that you just see that this is not a comma, but you just separate it with a dot. Also good to know is, if you start a project and just say new, you can just use a different kind of templates. For example, for large objects, you need you use meters, and if you use meters for small objects, then you have a higher tolerance, and if you use meters for large objects, then you have a smaller tolerance. The last thing is a basic setup. I really recommend that you immediately save your file, and also really important when you save your file, that after a short amount of time, that you not always work with the same file, that you probably just say you have a version 2, you have a version 3, otherwise you probably can't go back to an older version you did yesterday, and you just lost what you had. Wino is organized like many computer programs. You have a main menu bar at the top. You have different kind of side panels on the left, on the right. You have a workspace with 4 viewports. You have a status bar. And the first thing we want to look at is our main toolbar, our menu bar, and edit view are just quite normal normal functions, and it goes from left to right. It starts with a curve, and from the curve you go to the surface, and out of the surface you can make solid three-dimensional objects and then a mesh. So I think the hierarchy is quite clear, and there are different ways of how to draw, for example, the curve. The main menu bar is the slowest way of how to do it. The fastest way is the command bar, but you can also do it with the sidebar here on the left side. And so we just start our first curve, and I just go into the menu curve, and I just say a line and a single line, and then you can see that you get information in your command line. It asks you for the start of the line, and I just say I want to start it in the origin of my of my file at 0, 0, 0, and I just enter 0, 0. I could also enter the z value for 0, but I don't need this. 0.0 for x and y is absolutely fine, somewhere like this. And I can then, I'm asked for the end of the line, and this is also really interesting because it's always like this that the command line asks you for the next steps. You can also change parameters here, but that's not so important to me right now. And I just say I want to have the next point at 10, I think, meters, 10 meters in x direction and 10 meters in y direction, somewhere like this. And if I press enter like this, then I have drawn my first line. I also just want to show you the other functions, like using the left toolbar with surface and probably just the command panel for creating a solid. But before I do this, I just show you the head manual, the head panel, and this is really handy. If you just choose any tool, for example like surface, you just get information about how to create a surface, and this is really good for beginners. I zoom out a little bit with my middle mouse wheel, I can zoom out, and with right mouse click I can pan. I will talk about this a little bit later. And what I just do, I select my surface form object from 3 or 4 corner points, and I enter with my first corner in x direction 0 and then comma, and in y direction 0, and press enter. And I'm at the origin again, and I enter my second point. I just want to have 10 meters in x direction and 0 meters in y direction, somewhere like this. And now it's quite interesting, because if I want to get to this point, you have to again say 10 meters in x direction, 10 meters in y direction. And that's not always good, because you don't always want to think from the origin, so you can do something relative to the point where you already are. The way you do this, I first have to press enter, obviously. The way you do this, you just have to type an add, like the email ad, and then you are relative to the point where you are already. So what I want to do for the fourth point, I just want to go minus 10 meters in x direction, minus 10 meters, and comma, and 0 meters in y direction, and here we go, and I created my first surface. Don't worry about this if this was a little bit fast. We will get back to this a little bit later or in some other videos. What I want to show you is how to draw, for example, a box in the command line. And I just enter BO, and that you can already see that a box appears, and I just press enter. It asks me for the first point, and I just enter 10 in x direction, comma, 10 in y direction, and I press enter. Here we go. And then it wants to get the next point, and here I just also say 10 comma 10, and you can see it is at the same point. So we learned before, it's probably better to say add 10.10, and here we go, because now it just created the next point relative to the point where we were. And if I didn't use, would have used the add, it would have been at the same point. So just be aware of this. I just press enter again, and now it asks me for the height, and I just press 10, and here we go. If you want to repeat a command, you don't have to enter box again or whatever kind of command you use. You can just use your spacebar, and it just will use the last command, whatever it is. In this terms, it was creating a box, and there are also different ways of creating boxes or whatever you want. And for example, I just use now the setting diagonal. I just choose it, and I enter my first corner, and I want to have my corner point at in x direction at 0 and in y direction at 10. I just press enter, and now I can, you can also see that I go can go like this with the mouse. I just want from this point go into minus 10 and plus 10 in y direction, and you can see what happened, because what I need to do is I just have to enter my add again. I just enter add and say minus 10 and then 10, and this looks much better because now it's again relative to where I am. I just press my enter key, and now it wants me to enter the height. There's a difference now. I just enter 10 and finish with my enter key, and it did not finish, because now with my mouse, for example in perspective, I just can decide if it goes up or if it goes down. So it's a little bit different to the other way of drawing a box. I just say it should go down now, and I just press my left mouse key and I do another box. Before we look at the other menus, I just would like to talk about how to navigate with your mouse and your viewport. And what is really important is that you have a mouse with a middle mouse wheel, so you can zoom in and out. And if I just hold my right mouse and move my mouse, for example like this, then you can just see that you rotate. If you use the right mouse and the control or string key, then you can just see that you also can pan in and out. If you hold the shift key and your right mouse, then you can see that you can pan from right to left, up and down. And there's one thing really, really interesting. I would like to rotate around one object. I just draw another box here, and I would like to rotate around this, but I just can't do it. What you have to do is you can select this. It still doesn't work. And what you have to press, the control key or string key and shift. And if you hold control and shift, then you just turn around this object. And this is really something really important to practice and remember, because it's a really important way of how to navigate in your scene or around your objects. Okay, with your mouse you can navigate through your workspace, and if I look at my workspace in this terms, I have four viewports. I have perspective, I have top, I have front, I have the wide view, and I also would always recommend that you work in all of these four viewpoints. And the active viewport is always the one which is blue. I would swap between these viewports with using the white mouse key. So now the top view is selected, or this terms the front view, so I can always swap between these. You can also just press control or string and tap key, and if I just do this, and you can see that I can also change between my viewports. You can also use these kind of buttons at the lower area, and if you double click, for example, on top view, then you have this view expanded. And also here again, if you press your string or control key and your tap key, then you can toggle between your four viewports, perspective, top, and front and right, and double click again on my right viewport, and I'm back in this kind of setting where you can see all four viewports. You should practice this a lot before you continue the video. And the next thing I would like to look at the different kind of display modes in the viewport. I just double click on perspective, and you can just see this little arrow. By the way, everywhere where you can find in a computer program, for example, like Rhino, these arrows, there are submenus, for example, if you go on this, the different ways of how to draw lines or boxes, and I don't know, also in terms of how to pan, zoom, and things like this. So be aware, there are always more options. And I just click on this little arrow, and you can see different ways of how to display your object. You can just say, I want to have it in a shaded mode, looks like this, or in a render mode, really nice. It can be really nice, depends on your object, and ghosted mode. The other ones I'm not so convinced about, like this artist, obviously takes some seconds until it's set up. Definitely I don't want this. I go back into shaded mode, somewhere like this. All the other settings, we just talk about this in another video. Just because these changing this is happens quite often, you also have the option of middle mouse key. If you click with the middle mouse key, then you have a shaded viewport and wireframe viewport in one click, and you can just see if you go with mouse over there, is with your left mouse click you have shaded view, and if your right mouse click you are in wireframe mode. So again, left mouse click shaded and middle mouse click, and now right mouse click wireframe mode. And if you go on rendered preview with your left mouse click, you are in your rendered preview settings. Okay, we go back, double click on perspective, and I change a little bit the zoom of my different kind of windows. And you also saw there are other functions in my middle mouse click. If I just click with my left mouse on zoom extend, then you can see that it extends in the selected viewport. And if I go into middle mouse again and just say right mouse click on this button, it zoom extends all viewports, which is also sometimes really handy. Interesting is also how to select objects. Obviously, you can just click with your left mouse key, someone like this. And if I zoom out a little bit, I will show you different ways of how to select several objects. And you probably also already know this if you work with programs like AutoCAD. For example, if I go from right, if I hold my left mouse click and I go from right to left, then everything I touch is selected. Okay? If you go from left to right, then only the things are selected which are completely covered with my mouse selection I did right now. So it again, somewhere like this. The left thing is selected, and now also the lower area is selected from left to right. And if I just say it from right to left, then everything selected is selected which is touched. Last thing for the viewport, you can see the grid. You can change the grid. I just go into options, and I just go up and just have my grid. You can set the grid line count and the grid spacing. The grid spacing is now with 1 meter, and I just change it to 2 meters. And with this count, I'll probably go out again and I'll just zoom out, and you can just see that there's an end of the grid. I'll just go again into options, and I go up again into grid, and just say the grid minor count is 2 meters. It does not make really sense. I will change it afterwards. And I just change the grid count to 100. Then you can just see that the grid count is the size of the grid in total. And you can now see that my basic grid is now 2 meters, which does not make much sense. I will just change it. But it's good to know that you can work with a grid. And it makes sense to have a grid count of 1 meters and or 1 centimeters, depend on which kind of unit you work, and just have minor grids of 10. So this is 1 meter and 10 centimeters and 20, 30, 40, 60, 80, and so on. This is really good. And you can also just enter a grid in your command line, for example, like this. And you can just say show grid on or probably off, and you also have other settings for your grid. Above your viewports you have another tab bar or with commands. I think the standard bar is normally absolutely fine. You have a lot of options here, but you can also see that the really specific other things, also in terms of selection, a lot of options and how to transform, move things from A to B, or for the surface tools and things like this. Just be aware of that you can also use this one, and you probably should have the standard as your main tab on. And also on the right side you have toolbars, and it's really good and really important. For example, like properties, you can choose elements, for example, like these box, and you can see what kind of type this is. It's a closed extrusion. We come to this in another video, and you can also see that this is about materials. You can give it a material and whatever kind of things. You have a layer manager with different kind of layers, and when you see the objects, you probably want to know on which kind of layer this object is, and you can see this in this lower status bar. This object is in layer default, and if I just click on this, I can just change it and just put it into another layer, and now it's on layer 01, and it also changed the color. Anyhow, there are layers, and there are many menus or many panels you can show, and if you want to have more panels, you just go into this option menu, and you can't see it in my video right now, but I just select materials, and now I select materials and I have my material menu. I can also move them, probably take them out and move them in again, so there are definitely options of how to organize your white status bar and how to work with this. With layers, we also talk in another video about this in more detail. The last thing we want to look at is at the status bar in the lower area. It could be that it looks completely different than the one you see right now. For example, you probably can't see this line, and if you want to see this line, you have to go into Tools, Object Snap, and just see if Persistent Object Snap dialog is on. If it's off, it looks just like this. I go again into Object Snap, and I'll just say Persistent Object Snap on, and we already saw that you can see on which kind of layer my objects are. I change it now to layer 04, and you can also see that there is a layer color which you probably can just, doesn't make sense, for example like purple, you can change. This layer color is related to the layer. It's not always in a visualization that you can see these objects in this layer. It's a completely different thing. We talk about this also another time. You can see which kind of units you're working with. I'm working with meters right now, and these things are really interesting and really important, and we have a quick look, and there's also another video where we look at this a little bit more in detail. I switch everything off apart from grid snap, and if you just have grid snap on and you take this object, you can just see that it just moves in the grid, and this grid is now steps of 10 centimeters. and I'll just move it back again. It's not really interesting for me, by the way. I just switch this off, and the most interesting thing is the gumball. There is just a video about the gumball, and I just show you a very few things. This is the gumball, and you can see in my top view and also in my perspective view that there are some errors, and you can see the colors red, green and blue. And red, green and blue, a little bit like in our basic system here, red, green and also blue stands for X, Y and Z axis. So the red is always X, the Y is always green, and the Z is always blue. So it's quite good to be able to remember this. If you switch on and off the gumball, you can see these arrows. You can grab the red arrow and you can move your object in X direction, and you can move your object in Y direction, obviously in Z direction. If you click, for example, on the red arrow, you can also enter a value like I want to move it 10 centimeters in X direction, 0.10 or 0.1, the same, and then you moved it and 2 meters like this. You can also see that there is this a square, and the square always consists that you can move it in two directions, and you can also see in which kind of two. Now it's in X and Y direction. And if I turn this a little bit, you can see that it will change the color. So now this is in X and Z direction. And if I move this, now it's Z and Y direction, because it's blue and green. So this is quite helpful. And yeah, now you can see that I move it in Z and Y direction. There's also the option to scale, and these are these dotted lines. You can just select my Y direction and just scale it, and I just say string Z, go back. You can also just click on it and just say that you want to scale it to double in Y direction, somewhat like this. I just say string Z again, and if you press and hold your shift key, and then you can just see that you scale it in X, Y and Z direction, and this is also really important to know. Another thing you can see that you can rotate. If you just click on this elements, you can rotate it, and obviously you can also just enter a value and just say string Z, string Z. There are settings for the gumball, and in another video we talk about this in detail, but if you click on this little dot for a little bit longer than 1 second and leave it, then you can just see that it opens a menu, and there's the option of relocate the gumball. If I just go on relocate the gumball, I can just say I want to have the gumball at this point, and for this you should click on object snap, and then you can choose it. If you didn't click on object snap, then you can't really properly select it. So object snap is really important, and I want to move the gumball to not to the center of the object but to the corner, and I also have to set up in which direction it goes. So I click once here, and then I can adjust it. You just have to practice this a little bit, it's quite handy. And now the gumball is the center of my object moved to the corner, and I can just move this at this point, and just be aware of I selected object snap, and if I selected object snap, I can also move it now and move it to, for example, like the corners of my other objects. If I would not have selected object snap, then you can see that it just does not react. It could react to grid if I would switch on grid, but in this terms, object snap is really good and really, really handy. It could be that you use object snap and nothing happened. This is probably because you didn't select anything what you want to snap, and I would always recommend that you use endpoint and probably point, midpoint, center. So if you chose something like this, object snap should work. And there's a last thing I would like to show you, which is also really cool. It's a smart track. If I select smart track and now go to this X and Y selection, and I just go over this point, you can just say that it changed to a white point. And I take this point, it also just changed after 1 second to a white point. Then I can just move it and just snap to the where these two lines meet, and that's a really good way of adjusting or setting objects in space. If I select everything I do, then it's obvious I can just move these things around, string Z. But how can I just move it and copy it? With this, you just have to take the Alt key, and if you just hold the Alt key and I just select, for example, like the Y direction, then you can just see that you can move it and copy, and just say string Z again. And I just select everything, I hold the Alt key and click on, for example, like Y direction. And if I here enter 10, or probably 20, then you can see that I just copy it and move this just 20 meters up. You probably ask yourself the question, how can I, for example, just select one surface, the surface of this cube, and I can only select the cube? What you have to do, you have to hold a string or control key and shift. And if you hold control key and shift, or string key and shift, and you just select on this surface, then you can just see that you select the surface. You can also just deselect it and just select one of the borders, for example, like this. So that's a really good way of how to select not the whole object, but one element. And if I, for example, just select only this line and this edge, there's a new thing, even also with the gumball I didn't show you, that's this, these little dots. And if I just select these little dots, then you can just see that you can extrude elements with this function. And this is also a really handy tool and a really good workflow of how to extrude elements. I go in string Z, and now I just select my surface, and I also can extrude this, for example, like this. My recommendation at the end of the video, you should practice this a lot with relative mode, absolute mode, how to navigate with the mouse, how to navigate only around one object with string shift, how to draw different kind of cues with command panel and the side panel and things like this, and switch different kind of viewport settings to get familiar to this. And I think a good way of doing this is probably just draw any ways of patterns or little elements and just copy and paste them, so you feel at home with your new program Wino 6. Thanks for watching.